Good afternoon. So welcome to today's session. And today we would be more or less winding up a lot of things about electrostatic fields. So in the last class we saw about energy and how from energy we took on to the concept of potential difference. And from potential difference, we moved on to the concept of potential of a particular point with respect to a reference. And in today's class, we will see about dipoles and about the energy stored in a configuration of charges and the concept of energy density. So, what is a dipole? See, basically in physics, you have studied that there are three kinds of materials in general, as a broad classification. So they are conductors, which are very good conductors of electricity, and there are insulators or dielectrics, which do not conduct electricity, and there are in between the two you have the semiconductors, which is extensively used in electronic devices. So actually the concept of understanding dipoles is vital for you to understand the behavior of dielectric materials. And remember when we were discussing flux density, I told you if D is simply equal to epsilon naught E, I don't need two vectors because D doesn't contain any more information than what E contains, because I'm only multiplying it by a scalar quantity epsilon naught. So the concept of the need for two vectors, a flux density and a field intensity vector separately, is very important when you study dielectrics and the concepts of polarization. So an electric dipole is very important in these aspects. So first of all, what is an electric dipole? So an electric dipole is made of two charges of equal and opposite polarity and separated by a very small distance relative to some point externally where I want to find the effect of this dipole. Okay, so essentially dipole is the presence of two equal and opposite charges. So you just see here I have plus Q here and I have minus Q. Okay, and the distance between these two is d meters. Now I want, so this is a dipole, right? A small two charges, equal and opposite, separated by a very small distance. This D is exaggerated in the figure. So now I want to find the potential at a point P due to this dipole. Clear? So now you just think, you know, this is very, very small compared to this. So actually, if this is very small, then this point, right, would appear to, as far as this point is considered, these three lines joining plus Q and P and the center, which here in this case I have taken as origin for simplicity, and P. So this would appear to be parallel. So you just see here, if you just take this part of it, don't they look parallel? Yes. So if P is sufficiently far away from the dipole, far away means what? We are not talking in absolute terms. Far away in terms of this distance d, as opposed to this distance d, these three would appear to be parallel. Okay, so this I am calling as R1. R1 is from plus Q, and then I have R2. So the distance between R1 and R2 would be this distance. You know, this is this. So R2 minus R1 would approximately be equal to this, and if this is D, then, and this is theta, then I can say this is D cos theta. Okay, so here what is the approximation I am making? That all these three are parallel. So keep this figure in mind, and now we will see. So what is the potential at this point? It is a potential due to plus Q and the potential due to minus Q, or even the field intensity. The electric field intensity also would be due to this and this. So we'll make use of that concept. Okay, so V of a single point due to a single point charge is, you know, Q by 4 pi epsilon naught, and then here You see, this is at a distance of r1 and this is minus q at a distance of r2. So the potential due to both together would be q by 4 pi epsilon naught 1 by r1, okay, minus 1 by r2. This minus is because the second charge is minus q, okay. So I can write this as q by 4 pi epsilon naught r2 minus r1 divided by r1 r2. Now what was r2 minus r1? From the figure we saw it was d cos theta. So I can write v is equal to q d cos theta divided by, and approximately r1 and r2 I can assume it to be equal to r, is 4 pi epsilon naught r square. Did you get it? So this is the approximate potential, the approximate potential at a point which is at a distance of r from the dipole. I need not actually specify which end because the dipole distance itself is so small, okay. And d is the distance between the two charges, q is the charge, plus q in one and minus q in another, and theta is the angle it substance, this angle. So if this is d and this is cos theta, okay, so this is what we are doing. So I can approximately take theta to be the angle this r makes with the line joining the two charges. Simple? Yes. Now I have got the potential. So from the potential, see, there are many different ways different authors treat this dipole. So I have given you a simple definition and I have followed Haidt, which is essentially your textbook. There are other ways you can come to the same derivation. Now E we saw is minus gradient of V, right? And what is the gradient? If this is just, this is the equation for the gradient, this is just for your recollection. The gradient of a scalar quantity V is minus dou V by dou R AR. So I differentiate this with respect to R, okay? So I get 2QD cos theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R cubed AR, and then plus 1 by r dou v by dou theta a theta. So I differentiate this with respect to theta. So I have qd, differentiation of cos with respect to sine is minus sine theta, and I have an r here and a r square here, so that becomes r cubed a theta, and this doesn't contain any phi term, so this third term will be zero. Okay, so the field, electric field at any point E, is given by qd by 4 pi epsilon naught r cubed, okay, 2 cos theta ar plus sine theta a theta. So we have derived the expression due to a dipole for both the potential as well as the electric field intensity. Okay, so now where this is useful is, see, supposing you have a dielectric material, right, and there are number of atoms in it. Now if you subject it to a strong electric field, you keep the material in the presence of a strong electric field. Now what does an electric field do? It tries to push a positive charge in the direction of the field and a negative charge in the opposite direction. So what will happen is there will be a tendency for electrons to shift in a direction opposite to the electric field intensity. So therefore an atom which is electrically neutral will have the center of its positive and negative charge coinciding, but in the presence of a field the negative charge and positive charge shift. So actually they don't come away, electrons don't come out of the atom, they don't form an ion, but there is a shift in the center of the positive and negative charges, and this is as if you have a minus q and a plus q, and that is called as a dipole, and this whole effect is called as polarization. So you'll study more about this when you study dielectric materials. So at that time you recollect what we have studied about the dielectric. So now let's move on to the last topic, as I promised you, the energy density in electrostatic field. So now just first let us take point charge, okay, then we will move on to a general expression. So here you see I have so many point charges, q1, q2, q3, q4, qn, there are many charges, right? So now assume all these charges are at infinity, I have it at infinity. So now if I want to know what is the energy stored in a group of charges. That would basically be the energy you have spent in creating that charge configuration. So when you dismantle it, you will get back the charge. Okay, it's as simple as this. See, supposing I lift an object from the ground, right? I lift an object from the ground. So when I lift it, I am giving it a potential energy. Are you getting my point? I am giving it a potential energy. So now what happens? Where is that energy? The energy is stored somewhere. So now when I drop this object, that much of energy goes back into the system. I am able to recover it. Maybe in some other form. See, this potential energy which I have given, it will go back as kinetic energy. It will accelerate and come down. Okay. Now you have different ways of viewing this. When I lift the object and I say energy is stored, hypothetically you can say, where is it stored? Is it stored in this medium or is it stored in this object? Difficult, very difficult to tell when you talk of energy. So something similar we will apply to a group of charges. So the energy stored in a group of charges is basically the energy you spend in creating this group of charges. Okay, so let's assume they're all at infinity. Why have I assumed at infinity? Because I have taken that as the reference, right? So I'm assuming all these charges have zero energy at infinity, no potential. Now I bring in the first charge Q1 and keep it here. Okay, how much of energy do I need? I don't need any energy. Why? Because there is no field. Okay, I need to expend energy to bring a charge only if I am moving in the presence of an electric field. Right, now all my charges are at infinity. So when I bring the first charge, there is no electric field in that space where I am positioning it, and therefore I don't expend any energy from moving the charge Q1 from infinity to the point under concentration. Clear? So now I bring from infinity and keep Q1. Next, I go again to infinity and I bring Q2 and keep it here. So now when I keep Q2, what has happened? Already Q1 is there. So Q1 will be creating an electric field, right? So now I have to move Q2 against this field. You get it? Fine. And then when I bring Q3, what happens? So what is the energy required to bring Q2? It is Q2 into V21. Let me get this clear. What is V21? V21 is the potential at point 2. Be very clear. Is the potential at point 2 due to the electric field created by a charge at point Q1. Now the potential is the energy of a unit charge. So since I am keeping Q2, the total energy will be Q2 into V21. Okay, again I repeat, very important. This is the energy or the work done in moving Q2 and positioning it at location 2 in the presence of the field created by Q1. Okay, fine. So now I have kept Q1 and Q2. Now I bring in Q3. So when I bring in Q3, what happens? I have the potential at point 3 due to charge Q1 and due to charge Q2. Okay, so therefore when I bring Q3, my energy I spend or the work done is Q3 into V31. This is the potential at 3 due to charge at 1. Okay, and Q3 into V32, this is the potential at position 3 due to charge at Q2. So when I bring 3, I already have 1 and 2. So the potential at point 3 is the potential created both due to charge at location 1 and charge at location 2, and this is the work done. Similarly for 4, it will be due to 1, due to 2 and due to 3. And therefore, what is the total energy? I have to add everything. So this is the energy to bring charge Q2, one term, because I have only Q1. Then this is the work done in bringing Q3. I have two terms, 1 and 2 are already in place. This is the energy to bring in Q4 and so on. So it keeps adding. Got it? So now I want an expression, right? So let us see whether I can do something. So now what is Q3, V31? Q3, right? And what is V31? V31 is the potential at point 3 due to Q1. So it will be Q1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R13, that is the distance between 1 and 3. Now this term I can also write it as Q1, so this is only a product, Q3, Q1. So I'll take Q1 and bring Q3 here. Q1, Q3 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught. And instead of writing R13, I write it as R31, because the distance between 1 and 3 is a scalar distance, is the same as the distance between 3 and 1. Remember, it's a scalar distance. If it's a vector distance, then it'll be opposite. Okay. And what is this? This is Q1 into V13. Okay, so what, very important this part. So what am I trying to say here? The product of Q3 into the potential at 3 due to charge at 1 is same as the product of Q1 into the potential at 1 due to charge at 3. Are you getting what it means? What it means is, after you position Q1 and you bring Q3, whatever is the energy you expend is exactly same as if you bring Q3 and then you bring Q1 in its field. Both are the same. Okay. So what? Now what am I going to do? So now you look at these terms here, these energy terms. I will rewrite this energy using this. So I have WE. This is Q2 V21. Okay. And this we saw is same as Q1 V12. Okay, and this is Q3 V31, which is same as Q1 V13, and so on. Please remember, these two equations are exactly identical, and I'm writing it for a particular purpose. Right, so now let me add these two terms. So what do I get on the right hand side, on the left hand side, W plus W, I'll get 2WE, twice the total energy. Now let me take Q1 term. Q1 into V12, V13, V14, and I think I'll have V15, whatever you have. Then Q2 I have here, Q2, V21, and from this expression I have V23, V24, so on. Then Q3, here I have V32, and here you have, V34, V13, I go on adding. So what you have to see here is every term is actually repeated twice. I'm taking this equivalent. Q3 V31 is equal to Q1 V13, and I'm adding, so I get twice. And when I club all the common terms of Q1, Q2, Q3, this is what I get. Okay, now look at this. Q1, V12. What is V12? The potential at 1 due to charge Q2. And what is V13? The potential at 1 into due to charge at 3. And V14 is the potential at 1 due to charge at 4. Okay, so what is this first term? I have Q1 into the potential at point 1 due to all other charges other than Q1. Okay, Q1 into potential at point 1 due to all other charges. Similarly, Q2, and here see I have, what is this V21? The potential at 2 due to 1. V23, the potential at 2 due to 3. V24, so on. So I get Q2 into potential at point 2 due to all other charges. So you see, each term is the charge into the potential at that point due to all other charges. This is equal to twice the energy. That's the reason for this circus of showing Q1 V31, Q3 V31 is equal to Q1 V13. That's what I wanted to do. So now you see I get a neat expression. The term within the parenthesis, what we discussed, is the potential at that point due to all other charges. Therefore, WE is equal to half. Remember, the left side was 2WE, so I bring down 2. Q1 V1 plus Q2 V2 plus Q3 V3. So now I can write it in a compact form. The total energy. What is this energy? This is the energy you have spent in creating this charge configuration. Got it? This is the energy expended in creating this charge configuration. What is it equal to? It is equal to half of sigma. M is equal to 1 to n, assuming there are n point charges, Qm, Vm. Qm is the charge at point M and Vm is the potential at point M due to all other charges. Okay. So now this is discrete charges. A number of discrete charges are there. If I have to make it into a continuous charge distribution, I will write this as, you know, when you have, so in a continuous charge, like a line charge or something, what will I have? I have infinite charges, right? Because there are infinite point charges in a continuous charge. So in that case, this summation will become an integration. And the general form of any charge is the volume charge density. Okay. So this Qm is now rho v. Rho v is the volume charge density. And the potential V is the expression for the potential due to this into dV. dV is over the entire volume. Right? So this expression is useful if you want to find the energy stored in point charges. And this is a more general form of energy where WE is half integral volume rho V V dV. Rho V is the volume charge density. Clear? So both these are the same expressions written in different forms. Okay, so now just like I told you, if I lift this, where is the potential energy? Is it in the space in between or is in this object? Now look at this expression. Looking at these two expressions, where do you feel intuitively, where do you think the energy is stored? You will feel it stored in the charge. Just like thinking that the potential energy is stored in this object. Okay. So these expressions make us feel that the energy is stored in the charge. But remember, this whole thing will not be there if I don't have electric fields. Right. So let me see whether I can get something else out of it. Yeah. Now I make use of an expression to get an expression in terms of E and D. So this is a mathematical expression equivalent to. So the divergence of the gradient of D, the divergence of a scalar into a vector. So this is any general scalar and this is any general vector is mathematical. This is not field theory. Huh? This is a mathematical derivation. Okay. Only thing is I have just used the vector and scalar from fields. So the divergence of a scalar into a scalar product of a vector is the scalar into the divergence of the vector plus the dot product of the vector into the gradient of the scalar. Okay, this is a mathematical derivation. Okay, so now what I do is I take V into D. Okay, what is V? V is the potential and D is the flux density. So I can write this as, so now energy, you look at the energy. I'm having this term. Okay, so now what is the divergence of D? What is this term? So this is potential into divergence. I take it over a surface integral. Okay. Minus half into over this one. I take the volume. So basically I'm trying to evaluate this. This is equal to what? The divergence of D is equal to this term. Minus of this term. Minus of this term. And this all are integrals. If I integrate everything, I will get this. And now this, I have converted the volume integral to a surface integral. I have used many things. See, when I take the volume integral here of all the three, right? I essentially want the volume integral of this. Okay. It will be this minus of this, right? And this volume integral, you know, we can convert it into a surface integral. So it is half into the closed surface integral, right, minus half into the volume integral, right? And now this surface integral, again I convert it to the volume integral, I get this. Okay. So using this, I have used the divergence theorem. Basically, this is the theorem I have used to get this. So what am I doing? I am having two terms for the energy. And since one is the surface integral, which I have done using the divergence theorem, and another is the volume integral. And in getting this, I have made use of this mathematical expansion. Okay, just work it out. You will get it in one step. Now, what is this volume and what is this surface? Let us be clear about it. What is this volume? Now, I have rho v. If you look at my energy expression, it is integral rho v over the entire volume. What volume am I speaking of? My volume must enclose the entire charge. Right? If I only partially say this is my volume. Now if I take a volume inside, that will not give me the true energy because there is some charge which I have not considered. But I can take a volume outside because that encloses the total charge. Right? The rest anyway will not contribute to the energy density because I'll be moving in free space. So I must choose a volume. I must choose a volume which encloses the entire charge configuration. That is this volume. Okay. And what is this surface? This surface is the closed surface bounded by this volume. Are you getting it? This is my volume. This volume, my constraint is it must enclose the entire charge which I am considering. And the closed surface is the surface which this volume encloses. You remember? We said only closed surfaces enclose volume. That is the surface. Now, I am not telling you what should be the volume and what should be the surface. It can be anything. Your result will be the same. Provided the volume you are choosing encloses the entire charge which is under consideration. Now let us look at this term. Right. Now, the surface as a first approximation, the surface of any surface, okay, is proportional to the distance from the origin, r squared. Yes? Okay. So this term is proportional to r squared. And v is inversely proportional to r, 1 by r. You have a term 1 by r in v. And what about d? D is 1 by r squared, q by 4 pi r squared. So d is proportional to 1 by r squared. So if you look at this product vd, right, it is a function, it is proportional to 1 by r cubed. Get it? This term is proportional to 1 by r cubed. And what about the surface? It is proportional to 1 by r. Right. So as I make r bigger and bigger, can I say, see this term? So I can say is approximately proportional to 1 by r. It will taper off as a function of 1 by r. Right. And as I make r bigger and bigger, this term becomes smaller and smaller. Right. This term becomes smaller and smaller. Okay. Yes. But the total of these two, this should be the same energy. Energy cannot change. So you see, I have a group of charges, right? Whether I compute the energy using a volume just over it or much bigger than it, or even the volume I take the entire space, I should get the same energy because the energy expended is not going to change. Okay, so the sum of these two terms will be a constant, but as I go on increasing r, this term will become smaller and smaller. So if I tend r to infinity, this term will become zero. Okay, therefore, a very nice way of writing an expression for w is the energy is half, and what is gradient of v? We know is minus e. E is equal to minus gradient of v. So this term is minus e. I already have a minus here, so this becomes plus half d dot, this is e dv. Got it? So what have I done here? I have just got an expression for the energy stored in terms of the d and e fields. It's as simple as that. Now I can substitute either for e or for d. D is equal to epsilon naught e. So I can write it as half integral over the volume epsilon naught e squared dou v. Okay, or I can write it as d squared by epsilon naught dou v. Either way, I can write it in terms of E or D. Got it? Now, what is interesting about this term? You just look at this term. There is no charge in it. When I first went into the depths of field theory, I was really surprised with this expression, because there is no charge in it. Okay, so I got really surprised. And so now, when you look at this expression, what does it look like? It looks as if your energy is stored in the fields. Okay, whereas when you saw the previous expression, integral of rho v dou v, you feel that the energy is stored in the charge. But here it looks as if the energy is stored in the field, that is the space in between, because the field exists in the space, right? Which is correct? Very difficult. I don't think to this day physicists have solved this problem. They say it's an unanswered question in physics. Okay, we are not bothered. All that we want to know is, I have different expressions by which to calculate what is the energy stored in a system. I'm not bothered where it is stored. Okay, got it? So these are the different expressions for energy. So now from this, if I take a small charge, a small energy change, so I can write dWe is half d dot E into dV, and therefore dWe by dV, this is volume, is half d dot E. What does this give you? This gives you the energy per unit volume. So this is the expression for the energy density, right? So if you know the volume, multiply it by the volume, you get the total energy. If D and E are not constants and they're functions, then you have to do integration instead of simple multiplication. Okay, so now let's quickly take some problems, typical problems from your examination perspective. So consider four point charges of 0.8 nanocoulombs located at the corners of a square of side 4 centimeters. Find the total potential energy stored. Right, so I have q1, q2, q3, q4 like this. This is 4 centimeters, so this would be 4 into root 2, this distance. Now you see there is absolute symmetry. The potential at any point due to the other three charges is identical for all the others, because this is a symmetrical configuration, right? So all that I need to do is, I have to find the potential at any point, at any one point, and the potential at all the points will be identical. Remember, potential is a scalar, so I just need that number, right? And we have the expression for WE, the energy stored in a group of point charges, that is half sigma n equal to 1. I have 4 charges, 4 qn vn. Okay, so now let me find what is the potential at point 1 due to the other three charges. So what is it at V1, V21, V31, V41? The potential at 1 due to 2, due to 3 and due to 4. So the charge is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught. And the distance between 2 and 1 is 4 centimeters. And 3 and 1 is again 4 centimeters. And between 4 and 1 is 4 root 2 centimeters. So I get 1 by 0.04 centimeters, I'm converted into meters. Plus 1 by 0.04 plus 1 by 0.04 root 2. Okay, so this is the total potential. Now, what is WE? Half into 4. Why 4? All of them will have the same potentials. So that's why the 4. Q is also constant for all of them. So Q divided by this 2 and 4, 2 pi epsilon naught 0.04. So this is taken, right? And I get 0.779 microjoules. Remember, you can't do this approximation if this is not symmetrical. Then in that case, you have to use this formula and individually compute the potential at each of the points due to the other charges and multiply it and then take half. Submit and take half. Okay. Because of symmetry, I have exploited and simply multiplied by 4. Now, I place a charge of 0.8 nanocoulombs is placed at the center. Now find the potential energy. So look at this, what has happened? Now one more has come here at the center, right? So now find the potential energy. Again there is symmetry because I am placing it at center. So what do I have to do to this potential term? I have to add one more term, which is the potential due to this point charge, right? That is also same 0.8 nanocoulombs only. What is the distance from the center to any Q1? It is 4 root 2, the total one. So it will be half of that, that is 2 root 2, right? So therefore, that's the only change I have to make. It is the total, the previous energy plus energy of the fifth charge. When I add that, I get 0.813 microjoules. This is the energy of the fifth charge. I already have energy of the four charges. I have to add to that. Okay, or another thing you can do is, as I told, another approach to the problem is just add here plus 1 by 0.02 root 2. Add that term and keep this 4. That also will give you a same answer. Okay, either way you can approach it. As I said, I have repeated so many times, always draw the figure. The figure drawing really helps you to understand how to consider the charges, what are the distances you have to consider, etc. Now let me take one more example. A copper sphere of radius 4 centimeters carries a uniformly distributed total energy of 5 microcoulombs in free space. Understood? I have a sphere, radius is 4 centimeters, and I have 5 microcoulombs charged uniformly over the sphere. Now use Gauss's law to find D external to the sphere. Okay. So now what do? This I have a sphere. So my Gaussian surface will be a concentric sphere around it. Concentric sphere around it, right? And the charge enclosed would be the total charge, 5 into 10 to the power of minus 6, 5 microcoulombs, divided by 4 pi r squared. What is this expression, please? This is the field. This is the field at a point at a distance of r from the center, because I am taking a concentric sphere from the center of the charged sphere, and this point r is outside the charged sphere. Inside, obviously the field will be 0 because it doesn't enclose any charge. I have a surface, so inside the surface there is no charge, so that will be 0. Got it? Fine. Now in this, calculate the total energy in the electrostatic field. I have got the expression for D. I have got expression for D. So now let's see if I get the total energy stored. We'll use this. Integral volume half D dot E dou V, right? Now, this is half. D we know. E you know, D by epsilon naught, so that epsilon naught comes here, so the pi becomes pi square, 4 becomes 16, r square becomes r to the power of 4. Now I have to take the volume, so in spherical coordinates, you know the volume is r squared sine theta dr d theta d phi. Now let's come to the limits, right? So what did we say in this expression? This volume is, this volume is the volume of the entire space. Okay, so if you are considering Cartesian coordinates, it will be x, y, z varying from minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay, so now here I am considering spherical coordinates. So what are the maximum limits I can have? The radius is from 0.04 to infinity, because the charged sphere is at 4 centimeters, so there is nothing inside. So I have to go up to infinity because I need the entire volume outside. And theta can take from 0 to pi, and phi can take from 0 to 2 pi. So these two integrals will become 4 pi. Okay, and then I integrate. Here I only have this, so dr by r squared. Here I have this r squared and r to the power 4. I'm left with r squared, so I get integral of r, 1 by r squared is 1 by r, and I get 2.81 joules. Okay. My advice to students is, don't make mistakes in these integrals. This is all your PU integral, very simple integrals. Do it carefully. Okay, understood how to find the total energy? Fine. Now find out the capacitance of the isolated sphere. This is called as an isolated sphere because just I have one capacitor, one sphere, right? The other one I can assume it to be at infinity. In between I have space, which is a dielectric. So what is the capacitance of this? We want to find out. Fine, let's see. So you know from high school, the energy stored in a capacitor is half CV squared. Yes, and V is Q by C, okay? So it becomes half C Q by C whole squared. So the another expression for energy is half Q squared C, from which I can get C is equal to, from here I can get C is equal to Q squared by 2 WE. Q we know, 5 microcoulombs, 2 WE I have already computed, which WE over the entire volume, this is the energy stored over the entire space in that, and therefore I have the capacitance of the isolated sphere is 4.45 picofarads. So this problem, all these three subsections pertain to the same data. I have a charged sphere. I want the expression for the field outside. I want the energy stored in it, and I want the capacitance of the isolated sphere. This example is nice. I have a potential in field in free space. This is in Cartesian coordinates. V is equal to 20 divided by x, y, z volts. Okay, so this is the potential function. V is equal to 20 by x, y, z. Find the total energy stored within the cube, 1 less than x, y, z less than 2. What does this mean? So it is a cube, okay? So x, y, z, all of them vary from 1 to 2. That's what we want, right? So I want to find the energy stored with this potential. Okay, so first I have to, what do I use? I don't know the volume charge density. So you have so many expressions for potential, for energy. You should know which to use where. I cannot use integral rho v into d volume because I don't know the volume charge density, and this is not group of point charges, so I can't use half sigma qv. So the only option for me is to use half integral of d dot e. So let's see whether I can find out that. And we know since v is given, e will be minus gradient of v, right? So I have 20, right? Now I have to differentiate this expression with x, y and z to get the gradient. So differentiating with respect to x, I get x squared yz ax, then I get 1 x y squared z ay, this is differentiation with respect to y, plus 1 by x y z squared az, this is differentiation with respect to z, volts per meter. Clear? So now I have an expression for energy and expression for E, and what is D? D is equal to epsilon naught into E. So I take epsilon naught. Now I have to integral. What is my limits for integration? 1 to 2, 1 to 2, 1 to 2. Right? Now I want D dot E. Remember, D will have the same terms except that it will be multiplied by epsilon naught, which I have taken out. Right? So it is literally this vector into this vector. So what will I have? I'll have AX dot AX, but AX dot AY and AZ will be 0. So I'll get AX dot AX, that is 1 by X to the power of 4 Y squared Z squared here, plus this will become 1 by, again this into this will be X squared Y to the power of 4 Z squared, plus 1 by X squared Y squared Z to the power of 4 DX DY DZ. Alright, this is a triple integral. So whenever you do a triple integral, you assume two of the variables to be a constant and integrate first one variable and so on. Yeah, so you see here what I have done. I am first integrating only with respect to x. So I have retained the limits of y and z. Dy dz is there. Now you see each term I integrate with respect to x. So here y squared, z squared will be constant, so integral of x 1 by x squared. Then here it will be integral of 1 by, here it's x to the power of 4. This is x squared and this is x squared. So that integral works out to be, see, this is integral of x to the power of 4, that is minus 1 by 3 x cubed. Integral of 1 by x squared is minus of 1 by x. I get this expression. So here I have dy and dz, and x has to be substituted from 1 to 2. So I have simplified that, right? Next, what I do, I keep z and integrate each of the terms with respect to y. Okay, so here it will be 7 by 24. Integral of 1 by y squared is minus 1 by y, right? And integral of 1 by y to the power of 4 is minus 1 by 3 y cubed. And again, integral of y squared is minus 1 by y. So I do that. And I have 1 and 2 limits for y. So I substitute the limits here and evaluate this finite integral. Last, I'm left with only integration with respect to z. I do the integral. I get 387 picojoules. Got it? You have to be careful when you do the integration. It's simple. The expressions are not very complicated. Yeah, this will be my last problem for the day. Here, in the previous example, I had a sphere whose surface is charged. Okay, now I have a sphere which is uniformly charged. That means the solid sphere is charged. It's a volume charge. So I have charge in the volume of the sphere. So find the field at all points. So I have two points. I have a sphere which is completely charged. I have a point inside. So when you go inside, only a small portion of the charge is enclosed. Then I have a charge, when I have a point outside where the entire charge in the sphere is enclosed. Remember the difference, you know, get the difference between this and the charged surface. In a surface inside, there is no field because there's no charge inside. But if it's a volume, yes, you have a field inside also. So if I consider a point where r is less than a, that is inside, let me take a Gaussian surface. Okay, so Gauss law, I have d into 4 pi r squared. This is the area of the Gaussian surface, is equal to charge enclosed. Right, what is the charge enclosed? So I have rho naught, charge density, and I need the volume. So what is the volume? Volume is 4 by 3 pi r cubed. You know the volume of a sphere is 4 by 3 pi r cubed. What is this r? Remember, this r is a sphere inside, so all the charge enclosed by this sphere. Okay, so from which I get E is, you know, d by epsilon naught. So I get E is equal to rho naught r by 3 epsilon naught ar. This is the expression for field at a point inside the sphere, charged sphere. Charged sphere is different from a charged spherical surface. Now for a point outside, again I take a Gaussian surface as a sphere, right? So here again the area is 4 pi r squared, and what is the charge enclosed? It's an entire charge in the sphere of radius a. So it is 4 by 3 pi a cubed. A is the radius of the sphere. R is the radius of the Gaussian surface. So I get E is equal to epsilon naught a cubed by 3 epsilon naught r squared a r. Now you can substitute at the surface. What happens? At the surface, r is equal to a, right? R is equal to a. So this r squared and a cubed, one will get cancelled, so you'll get rho naught a by 3 epsilon naught, rho naught a by 3 epsilon naught. And look at the previous expression here also. If r is equal to a, you get rho naught a by 3 epsilon naught. So which means that, so here you see all are constants here except r. So the field inside tapers off as r squared. Okay, as r squared, and the field outside tapers off as r. So as you go from the center, the field will increase, reach rho naught a by 3 epsilon naught at the surface, and then again fall off. But it is continuous. Why continuous? whether you calculate at the surface the field from the expression inside or from the expression outside, you get the same answer. But if it's a spherical surface, something interesting is going to happen. The field inside is zero, the field inside is zero, but the field outside I have, right? It is Q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. So what is happening at the surface? At the surface there is a discontinuity. At the surface there is a discontinuity. So it is zero and then suddenly it jumps to Q by 4 pi epsilon naught r square and then it tapers off. Whereas here in a volume charge there is no discontinuity at the surface. Whereas with a surface charge there is a discontinuity at the surface. Clear? Fine. Now, the potential at a point r inside the sphere is I have the sphere, I'm moving a charge from infinity up to the point inside. Okay, so what happens outside? I am moving in one field and inside I am moving in another field. We saw just now the field expressions for field are different inside the sphere and outside the sphere. So from infinity to the surface I move in E2. And from surface to inside, I move in E1. That is the field inside. So you get the expression for the potential. You get the expression for the potential. Okay. And I have WE. Now I can use half of, I use the expression using V. Right. And then here again look at the limits. From 0 to A, because the charge is only from 0 to A. And 0 to pi and 0 to 2 pi. I get the entire, due to the entire charge, I get this as the expression for the energy. So these problems, maybe I'm a bit fast because I want to finish this. I don't want to leave it. Kindly work it out. They're simple enough. And the integrals are also simple. And the only place where you are likely to make a mistake is in the evaluation of the integrals. Here, what have I used expression here? I have used, you know, WE, the crude form, half integral rho into V. Rho is rho naught, right? And I have derived the expression for V, that's why this rho naught squared do volume or the volume. That is the expression I have used. So if you look at these problems, I have used different expressions. I have calculated the energy once using D and E because that was easy to compute. Then I have also computed using rho and V. If I know rho, right? And we have also computed using Q and V in case of point charges. So there are so many expressions. You should take a call and find out which expression is to be used in the context and with the data available for you. Okay. Now find energy using energy density. Right. Okay, the energy density inside is half into epsilon naught E1 squared. We saw that. We have already derived the expression for the energy inside, for the field inside. So I calculate the energy density here inside. And this is the energy density outside, half epsilon naught E2 squared. This is the energy density. So this is for expressions R less than A and this is for R greater than A. Right. So inside from 0 to A, this is the expression for the energy density into the volume. Okay, this is rho energy. This is simply energy density into volume. Okay, and this is again from A to infinity. Are you getting what I'm doing? I have a charge sphere. I am finding the density inside, right? Due to the energy density inside, where I'm using the field which I have computed for a point inside. Then I find the energy density outside, where I use the field I have computed for points outside the sphere. Now what is my total energy? The energy density into volume of the sphere, right, up to the surface. Then the energy density outside into volume up to infinity. I have to take the entire one. So you see, and in both cases the theta and phi vary from 0 to pi and 0 to 2 pi. So inside the sphere the limits on the radius is from 0 to A, from inside to the surface, and outside it is from A, from surface to infinity. And you have all the expressions. So this is the expression for the energy. Now you will find this is the same as what I got previously. So this is the energy I got from this expression using E field. And this I have got using the energy densities. So this problem is just to illustrate to you that the energy can be calculated in different ways, and you have to know which has to be used. So with this I close my session. So right now we have covered a lot of electrostatics. So now you are completely aware of charges, different types of charge configurations, and then the field due to point charges, the field due to volume charge, due to line charge, surface charges. What is the meaning of energy? What's the meaning of energy density? How do you calculate potential? How do you calculate energy? And different, how to use different expressions. And we have covered sufficient number of problems. So with this I will end the class.